Last week we began our study of the parables that Jesus told in Matthew chapter 13, and we talked a little bit about why Jesus spoke in parables. Jesus spoke in parables, he said, because he wanted to help people to dig deeper. That he was not making this truth easy to find. He was speaking in parables because if you were willing to put in the effort, there was great wisdom and knowledge and understanding that could come from studying the parables. But at the same time, there are many people who are unwilling to put in the effort. And to those people, the truths of Scripture remain hidden. Jesus was a master at telling parables because he understood the importance of a good image. And he understood that an image has a tendency to stick with us and to help explain things in a way that other forms of explanation wouldn't work. Because you can take something that is confusing, and if you can relate it to something that we understand very well, it helps us to understand the confusing thing that much better. And then that understanding sticks with us. And as we saw, Jesus was he's just phenomenal at this. There's a great deal that we can learn from him as teachers in how to communicate. But there's also a great deal that he tries to communicate to us through these images. And this morning, we're going to look at three images that Jesus shares. And each of these images, he says, is a depiction of the kingdom of heaven. And so we're gonna take a look at each of these in turn this morning. And the first one is the parable of the wheat and the weeds. And we see this in verses 24 through 30. It says, here's another story Jesus told. The kingdom of heaven is like a farmer who planted good seed in his field. But that night, as the workers slept, his enemy came and planted weeds among the wheat, then slipped away. When the crop began to grow and produce grain, the weeds also grew. The farmer's workers went to him and said, "Sir, the field where you planted that good seed is full of weeds. Where did they come from?" "An enemy has done this," the farmer exclaimed. "Should we pull out the weeds?" they asked. "No," he replied, "you'll uproot the wheat if you do. Let both grow together until the harvest. Then I will tell the harvesters to sort out the weeds, tie them into bundles and burn them, and to put the wheat in the barn." Now, this is an interesting story, and again, it's an image that everyone there probably would have been familiar with because, again, it's a farming community, a farming area. They would have understood this. But one of the challenges for us in understanding the parables is that we have to kind of go back in time. You remember that Jesus was telling these parables to people who lived in a different time, a different climate, a different culture than we do. And so in order for us to understand, we kind of have to transport ourselves back and put ourselves in the position and in the mindset of someone who would have been one of his original hearers. Because each of these parables would have communicated very clearly to them, but some of these things are lost on us. Now, we look at this and we say, listen, we understand the tyranny that is weeds even today. You know, even with modern agricultural techniques and modern herbicides, weeds are still a thorn in our sides, if you'll forgive the labored metaphor there, that weeds are still annoying to us, right? So we go, well, we understand this. Yes, to a degree. But this was probably speaking about a very specific weed. This was probably talking about a very specific problem that wheat farmers in that region dealt with. And the weed that they're probably talking about is called the bearded darnel. And the bearded darnel was a weed that had a tendency to grow alongside wheat. The problem with the bearded darnel is that when it started to grow, it looked exactly like wheat. Like it was indistinguishable. Even a farmer who had been farming all his life, probably when it was early, could not tell the difference between wheat and bearded darnel if they were growing right next to each other. And so you didn't know that the weeds were there until the weeds had grown up and become mature. And at that point, now you could begin to see, well, this is wheat and this is darnel. Well, the problem was this. The root system of the bearded darnel would intertangle itself with the roots of the weeds. And so if you went to try and pull the bearded darnel, you would destroy your wheat as well. And so this is what Jesus was telling them. This is probably a very specific example that they were all very familiar with. And so you can understand that if this was something that they were familiar with, when Jesus tells this story about someone, some enemy coming at night and planting this seed, this weed in the field of wheat, You can imagine people going, well, that's just terrible. I mean, what a terrible idea. And we say, well, that's far-fetched. Apparently it wasn't. There were laws on the Roman books about doing exactly this, that apparently this was a way that people got revenge with someone. You go to your enemy and you go plant this kind of wheat or this weed in their field of wheat, and it's tremendously terrible for them. And so what was the solution to this problem? Well, again, you couldn't pull the weeds, and so you had to wait until harvest time. And then they would go and meticulously separate out all of the bearded darnel from the wheat. Because the bearded darnel, if you ate the seeds of that, would make you sick, and it tasted bitter. So you had to get all of it, because just a little bit of the bearded darnel being left over would destroy your entire wheat crop. And so that's kind of what Jesus is telling them. That when we get into that mindset, we understand that he tells them this picture, and they all go, yeah, okay, we get this. We can see this. We can imagine exactly what this was. But what's interesting is that he doesn't explain the parable to them. He just tells this story, and he says, the kingdom of heaven is like this. There was this farmer, and then he tells them this story about something that they all would have been very familiar with, and that's the end of the story. He doesn't explain to the crowd who's gathered there what this means. Now, fortunately for us, the disciples later on asked him. Everyone else was set was left to just sit and wrestle with this question. But the disciples later on ask him, and we see this in verses 36 and following. It says, then leaving the crowds outside, Jesus went into the house. His disciples said, please explain to us the story of the weeds in the field. Jesus replied, the Son of Man is the farmer who plants the good seed. The field is the world, and the good seed represents the people of the kingdom. The weeds are the people who belong to the evil one. The enemy who planted the weeds among the wheat is the devil. The harvest is the end of the world, and the harvesters are the angels. Just as the weeds are sorted out and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the world. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will remove from his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. And the angels will throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in their Father's kingdom. Anyone with ears to hear should listen and understand. So what Jesus is saying is, he says, here's the symbolism of this. The field is the world. He says, I'm the farmer. And the good seed represents those who are part of my kingdom. The bad seed represents those who are enemies of God. And he says, there's coming a day when there will be a harvest. There's coming a day when everything will be revealed, and the good seed and the bad seed will at that time be separated. But right now, both are still present in the world. And so again, it's tempting for us to look at this and we say, well, obviously that's what it means. Well, it wasn't so obvious to them. We've got this explanation. But that's what Jesus says this means. And so there's a great deal of lessons and applications that we can draw from this, but for now, let me settle on, there's two lessons that I think we ought to see in this. First is that we shouldn't be so quick to judge other people. Jesus tells us that there are wheat and there are weeds, and often they are unrecognizable until harvest time. And so, you know, it's really tempting for us to look at the exterior appearance of people, to look at the things that they do or the things that they say or the things that they don't do or the things that they don't say and conclude that we know everything about them. We don't. We are not able to judge a person's heart. Now, this doesn't mean that we compromise on sin and say, oh, it doesn't matter what you do. That's not true. It's not saying that we don't say that when someone does something that is sinful, that we call it sin. But we do say, I can't know your heart. I don't know where you are. I don't know whether you are truly a follower of God or not. And it's not my responsibility to know that or to make that judgment or determination. It is God's. And so I won't try and pass judgment on other people. I will wait for the harvest and allow the one who truly knows to render the only judgment that is fair. The second is that we have to be careful, because not everyone who looks like wheat is wheat. There are a lot of people who are going to talk a good game, who are going to sound really good, and yet will be leading us astray. We need to be aware that there are weeds within the church. And so we have to be careful not to allow ourselves to be taken in by those who may be leading us astray. And there's a lot of people who lead people astray and don't even realize that they're doing so. It's not intentional. They just don't know any better. We say, well, how do we guard against that? Well, we guard against being led astray by those who are teaching false doctrine by studying the Word of God for ourselves. That's where we come to. We have to look back to God's Word and test everything that we are taught against it and say, is what people are saying, does that match up with what God's Word says? Because that's the only thing that we can really be trusting. Because everyone else, we don't know where people are, and so we must be careful. Now, I need to tell you something, that we need to understand that weeds can even be Christian leaders. Just because someone stands behind a pulpit or stands on a platform that's 18 inches higher than everyone, or because they've got hold a whole bunch of degrees, or they know a whole bunch of words, or they can quote Greek or Hebrew to you, doesn't mean that we can just trust whatever they say. We must always listen critically. We must always be careful. And we must always test things against God's Word and say, is what they are saying really borne out in what God has said in Scripture? If not, then we should not listen to them. But we shouldn't just blindly listen to those around us, because there are weeds even within the wheat field. So that's the first parable that Jesus talks about here, is this wheat and the weeds. Now, the second two parables really kind of go together, and so we're going to kind of look at them together, but we're going to look at them each in turn here. So the first one is the parable of the mustard seed, which is in verses 31 and 32. It says, here is another illustration Jesus used. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed planted in a field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but it becomes the largest of garden plants. It grows into a tree, and birds come and make nests in its branches. So Jesus uses this example of a mustard seed, and he says a mustard seed is really, really small. And yet, when it grows, it becomes this massive bush that is steadfast, immovable, and it benefits those around it. The birds have a place to come and nest in it. And what he is saying is that the kingdom of God is like that, that very small things can make a tremendous difference. God can use very small efforts, small faith, small little things that we do to create a massive impact in the world around us. Now, some people have claimed that Jesus was wrong here, because they say, oh, well, Jesus says that the mustard seed is the smallest of all seeds, and they say it's not. So Jesus was wrong, and so we can't trust the Bible. Well, first of all, let me give you a picture of mustard seed. I've got a couple here. One, that gives you a sense. This is a very, very small seed. You see, just between the two fingers there, you can barely see it. And I've got another picture here that's of a mustard seed next to a penny. Okay, so a mustard seed is really, really small. But it's true that there are seeds that are actually even smaller than that. Here's the thing. I think Jesus knew that. You know why? Because he created those seeds. I'm pretty sure he knew that there were smaller seeds than the mustard seed. Jesus wasn't speaking as a botanist. He wasn't trying to make some scientific truth. He was trying to communicate. And here's the thing that we have to understand about that society. In that society, the smallest seed that you planted for crop was a mustard seed. The smallest seed that you planted for crop was this mustard seed. And as a result, this concept of a mustard seed had become part of the vernacular. What people said at that time was, if there was something that was almost imperceptibly small, you'd say, oh, it's as small as a mustard seed. It's a way of saying, you know, that it's so small. Like if you cut yourself, but, you know, it wasn't bad, you'd say, man, I only bled a drop about the size of a mustard seed. So what Jesus was saying, he wasn't making a scientific statement. He was saying something that would have communicated to his audience. Listen, even a mustard seed grows into something that's massive, and the kingdom of God can be as small as a mustard seed. But look what God will do through us, just as he has done in this tiny little seed. Which leads into his second illustration, which is about yeast. And we see that in verses 33 Well, I guess just verse 33. This is what it says. Jesus also used this illustration. The kingdom of heaven is like the yeast a woman used in making bread. Even though she put only a little yeast in 3 measures of flour, it permeated every part of the dough. Now, even today, we are familiar with yeast. If you've baked bread at all, or if you're like me and you haven't baked bread, but you've watched other people bake bread, then you understand the magic that yeast is. Yeast is a fungus. Sorry to burst your bubble, but yeast is a fungus. But what yeast does is it's a living organism that breaks down sugar. and it breaks down sugar, and when it does so, it releases carbon dioxide. And so what happens is you put, you make your dough, right, and you put in the yeast, and you knead the yeast into the dough, and what happens is that yeast begins breaking down the sugars in the dough, and it releases carbon dioxide. Well, what happens when you release gas into dough? It rises. And so we end up with dough that is now no longer, you know, fat and, or flat and cracker-like, but we end up with dough that is delicious and that I will eat a whole bunch of if you were to make homemade bread. Sorry, I'm getting sidetracked. But Jesus talks about this because this is something that we all would have understood. Yeast is the magic that makes bread delicious. Because, again, bread without yeast is not really that appetizing. And what he is saying is, he says, the kingdom of God is this way. Just a little bit works its way through the entire batch of dough and transforms that dough from the inside out. It doesn't take much, but as it does a little bit at a time, as it breaks down one molecule at a time, it releases a little bit more gas, and it transforms this dough into something that's not, from something that's not very appetizing at all, into something that is delicious and is beneficial. It says that is what the kingdom of God is like, and that's what we should be like. We should be people who need to understand that our efforts, though at times they seem like they're not making much of a difference, ultimately can have a big difference, because God will use us to transform our society, to transform the bit of dough that he has placed us into and make a profound difference in that. Now, something else that we have to understand about this passage or about this illustration is that yeast is actually a very common illustration in Scripture. And yet, every other time that yeast is talked about in Scripture, it is talked about in the idea of yeast being representative of sin. And what the idea there is that sin, if we compromise with sin a little bit, it works its way through us. It permeates its way through our lives. And so there are some people who say, well, what we need to understand is that Jesus wasn't saying that the church is like yeast and that the church will transform the world. But what they are saying is that the world is like yeast and the world will transform the church if we don't keep our eyes out for it. Here's the thing. I think both interpretations are valid because both things are taught in Scripture. Both things are told to us that these are true statements in Scripture. And so what we need to understand is both sides of this. One is that if we allow ourselves to be transformed by God from the inside out, he will use us to transform the world from the inside out. However, if we compromise with sin, if we allow ourselves to become molded into the pattern of the world, we're going to find that just that little bit of compromise begins to work its way into other areas of our lives. And we'll be led astray. And the world will begin to transform us rather than the other way around. And so I think we have to be careful and we have to make sure that we are the ones who are doing the transforming. That God is the one who is doing the transforming. And so we need to submit to him. We need to seek after him so that we can have the impact that the yeast has in a loaf of bread. You know, these are all three very vivid pictures. They communicate well even 2,000 years later. And so it's important, I think, still for us to come and to say, what is it that Jesus is trying to teach us? How should we take these truths that he's taught us and apply them to our lives? And I came up with four different applications from what we read in these verses. First is that we've got to guard against false teaching. False teaching is all around us. There are weeds in the world around us. And so we need to make sure that what we are being taught matches up with Scripture. And so that means that when you're sitting in a sermon, look up the Scripture references that a pastor talks about. I'm not just talking about when you go to those other churches with non-godly pastors. I'm even talking about in our church. Make sure that anyone that you are sitting under, that you are checking out what they have to say. Do that in a Bible study, in a Sunday school class. When people are teaching you things, make sure that you are looking to Scripture and saying, is this what the Bible actually teaches? Because there are a lot of people in churches and in Bible studies, Christians today, who believe all sorts of things that are unbiblical because someone at one point said, well, you know, this is what the Bible teaches, or this is what God is like. And we've got to be careful. Just because someone was popular and said that doesn't make it true. Just because we've known that person doesn't mean that it's true. We need to make sure that we go ahead and we check out what people are saying against Scripture. Now, this isn't saying that we become the spirituality police and that every time someone misspeaks or says something that we try and pick out things for them. But we need to make sure that we are not allowing ourselves to be influenced in ways that lead us away from God. But with that, we've got to understand that that doesn't just happen in church, in Bible study, in Sunday school. You know, it happens in conversations with other Christians. We sit there and we talk and we say, well, you know, I think this is what God is doing, or I think this is what God is like. And that happens sometimes. And again, we've got to check that out against Scripture. It happens. The things that influence us, the things that change our beliefs, are sometimes little things. The TV shows that we watch, the movies that we view, the books we read, the websites that we go through, the links that people post on Facebook that we click and base our theology off of. All of those things begin to influence the lens through which we view the world. All of those things are teaching us something, and we need to learn to read and to listen and to watch critically. Not that we are to be critical, but that we need to not just allow things to enter into our hearts without checking it. We need to look at things and say, what is it that this is teaching me? You watch a movie and say, what was the message that they were trying to communicate to me? What were they saying about this or that? And ask those kinds of questions and say, does that match up with what the Bible tells me? We need to be critical or critically thinking in the way that we allow things to influence our lives, because a little bit of false teaching can work its way into us, and then it will have destructive consequences. Second, we learned that God will not allow evil forever. You know, one of the biggest arguments that people make against Christianity is they say, listen, if there's a God, if there's this God that you say is good and who loves people, why would he allow all of the hurt and all of the evil in this world? Why would he do that? Why wouldn't he just get rid of it? You know, this passage seems to answer that to some degree or another. So should we pull out the weeds, they asked? No, he replied. You'll uproot the wheat if you do. Let both grow together until the harvest. Then I will tell the harvesters to sort out the weeds, tie them in the bundles, and burn them, and to put the wheat in the barn. Jesus is saying, listen, there's a time. Evil's going away. I'm not going to endure evil forever. But the time's not right yet. We say, well, how do we know when the time's right? I don't know. How do we know when that's coming? I don't. But God knows when the time is right. God's got a purpose for allowing this. He says, if I were to take care of this right now, the wheat wouldn't reach its full maturity. I don't know how that works, but I know that he does. And so what we have to understand is that even as we look at the world around us, and sometimes we find ourselves experiencing the effects of evil, and we say, why is this here? Remember, it's not here forever. God will eventually eradicate evil once and for all. Third, this passage teaches us that we've got to examine our own hearts. You know, it's tempting to look at a passage like this and we say, oh, Jesus is talking about the wheat and the weeds. Clearly, I'm the wheat. I'm in church, right? He's talking to those people who are not holy. What we learn from this passage is that just because you find yourself in a wheat field doesn't guarantee that you are not a weed. Weeds grow in the wheat field. And so the temptation for us is to look around at the people around us and say, you know, I'm around Christians. I'm doing the things that Christians do. I look like everyone else. Yeah, so did those weeds. The question is, what's in our hearts? That's really what determines the factor. It's not until the harvest that things are really revealed. And God looks at our hearts. He's not looking at these outward things. You know, we can fool a lot of people. And there's a lot of people who play the game of Christianity, people who go through the motions, people who learn the right things to say, who learn the right things to do, and when to stand up and when to sit down, and they know all the words to the hymns and the choruses, and they can quote Bible verses at you, and they know a whole bunch of big words and make themselves sound really smart, and yet their hearts are far from God. And so we've got to ask ourselves, where is my heart? What is it that I'm seeking after? Am I seeking to draw closer to the Lord, or am I seeking after the things of the world? What is it that I am drawing towards? What is it that I am really putting my efforts on? Because those things give us a glimpse into our hearts. If we are not seeking after the Lord, then we need to ask ourselves whether we really are wheat or whether we have been led astray. Fourth, we need to remember the power that is at our disposal. God tells us that there's great power that he has given to us. He says, you have the power to be like a mustard seed. You have the power to be like yeast. You can transform the world if you work with me. I can use you to do things that you would have never imagined. And that's an encouragement to us, because there's times when we feel like we're trying to serve the Lord and we feel like it doesn't get us anywhere. We say, Lord, I'm trying to be faithful to you. I'm trying to do what you've told me to do. And it doesn't seem like it's doing anything. Remember, yeast converts one molecule of sugar at a time. Doesn't seem like much, but as it converts each molecule, by golly, if that doesn't compound and make a big difference. We need to remember the impact that we can have on the world around us. And at the same time, we need to remember that our decisions matter. Little actions can make a big difference. A little bit of compromise can begin to permeate our lives. We compromise in this one little area and say, oh, it's not a big deal. Guess what? That begins to move. There's another area of our lives where we say, that's not a big deal either. And I remember talking to someone one time, and they were involved in some stuff that they shouldn't be involved in, and they said, don't worry, I've got some lines I would never cross. I looked at him and I said, can I ask you a question? Sure. The lines that you would have never crossed a year ago, have you crossed them now? Well, yeah, but these lines, I don't buy it. A little bit of compromise causes us to keep drifting away from the Lord. We need to be on guard. We need to understand the power that he's given to us in our choices. We have the choice to be transformed from the inside out by God, or the chance to be transformed by the world. Look at yourself and say, what are the things that I'm developing in my life? What habits am I developing? You say, well, I'm not really developing any habits. You don't always have to work at developing habits. They just happen sometimes. Look at the habits that are developing in your life. Where do those lead? What are those things going to point us to? Are they going to draw us closer to the Lord? Are they going to pull us further away from him? Develop good habits. Work towards holiness. And if you will, he will change you. Stephen Covey, who wrote the classic book, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, stated this same principle very eloquently, and this is what he said. He says, sow a thought, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap a character. Sow a character, reap a destiny. Little things make a big difference. God can use little things to transform the world. And the world can use little things to transform us. You know, farming is hard work, I've been told. Good crops don't just happen. Good harvests only come as a result of doing the things that you know need to happen ahead of time, often before the plants even come up. It's important to do what's needed so that the harvest comes and we are pleased. Jesus tells us the harvest is coming one day soon in our lives. So, my encouragement to you is to do what's needed now so that you won't be disappointed come harvest time. Will you pray with me? Lord, we We hear these words and we are challenged by them. We are convicted by them. We are tempted to look at these parables and conclude that we are the good characters in the parables. And yet so many times, if we're honest with ourselves, we've got more in common with the bad characters. Lord, we don't want to find ourselves constantly looking over our shoulders to feel like we have to earn our salvation. We are grateful that we don't have to be good enough in order to be forgiven, to have an eternal life. But Lord, we do recognize that you've told us that we have a role here. We have a responsibility to seek after you. And if we will, you will change us. You will change us from the inside out, and even more than that, you will use us to change those around us. Lord, that excites us and it scares us. We're excited at the possibility of seeing what you could do through us, but we're scared because we're afraid it might take some hard work. Remind us that it does, but that it's worth it. So help us to seek after you. Help us to prepare the fields of our hearts that you may grow within us what you want us to grow, that we may yield a rich harvest that honors you, the farmer who has planted the seeds and cultivated them within us. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.